Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, consultant neonatologist. So we have had a couple of videos so far on oxygen. So the first one was giving an overview of oxygen, why we need oxygen, what happens in the lack of oxygen in the body, how oxygen is delivered to the tissues and so on. In the second part, we discussed pulse oximetry in detail as well as some of the other tools that we use to measure oxygen. In the following videos, we will be discussing oxygen toxicity in this video, followed by oxygen saturation or management in the labor room, and then finally oxygenation in the NICU, mainly focusing on the saturation targets. So we will go through the PowerPoint presentation as we speak. So the objectives of this video is to give you an overview of oxygen toxicity and the antioxidant system, as well as an outline of how oxygen impacts on our various diseases, including bronchopulmonary dysplasia and retinopathy of prematurity. So just a few definitions to start with. So we have hypoxemia, where there is reduced oxygen carriage in the blood. As we discussed in the first video on oxygen, this can be related to pulmonary factors which affect gas exchange or right to left shunting. The next aspect is hypoxia, where there is reduced tissue oxygen. So this can be related to reduced oxygen in the blood, which is hypoxemia, or it can be due to reduced cardiac output, severe anemia, or a combination. Hyperoxemia mainly results from excess oxygen administration relative to patient needs. So there is more oxygen in the lungs, and when the lungs are relatively normal, more oxygen gets into the bloodstream. We have a higher partial pressure of oxygen in the blood. Hyperoxia is where there is excess oxygen at tissue level. So both hypoxia and hyperoxia are harmful. Hypoxia can be harmful in terms of switching to anaerobic metabolism, which is quite an energy inefficient way. So we have energy failure. So details of this are available in the first video on oxygen as well. Acid accumulation in the tissues results from anaerobic metabolism, and so metabolic acidosis happens. When the acidosis worsens, it affects the myocardial functioning and it can lead to further hypotension and shock. Pulmonary vasoconstriction is also a result of hypoxia, and this leads to further hypoxia by the resulting right to left shunt. So this is another cycle which worsens the hypoxia. Due to the hypoxic injury, we have damage to the membranes. Apoptosis might happen, and this might increase the mortality. It also has effect on different organs, especially the brain. And the neurologic injury can be associated with the adverse long-term neurodevelopmental outcome. If the hyperoxia is prolonged or severe, it can be harmful in any age group. So hyperoxia is seen much often in the neonatal unit. We are not worried much about it in the full-term babies, but we should be, because oxygen can be harmful, and oxygen should be treated like a drug. As we prescribe other drugs, we should be clearly monitoring. The advantage of oxygen monitoring is that the nurses can be trained, they are by the bedside, they can titrate the oxygen, and of course, as we will discuss in one of our future videos, we have a closed-loop oxygen system as well, which can help regulate the oxygen delivery to the saturation which is measured. So preterm neonates are at a much higher risk from the hyperoxia effect. They are at risk of retinopathy of prematurity. We will discuss in detail about how it works in one of the next slides. There is increased risk of bronchopulmonary dysplasia from exposure to oxygen-free radicals and the related damage. One of the underlying factors is obviously the immaturity of the retina in terms of ROP, the immaturity of the lung, and a higher need for respiratory support and oxygen in terms of the lung disease. And this also is related to the fact that the preterm infants lack a fully functioning antioxidant defense system, including glutathione peroxidase and superoxide dismutase, and they are more exposed to other aspects which can worsen this defense. A quick summary of what oxygen toxicity is caused by. So we have the reactive oxygen species, which we will keep referring as reactive oxygen species, or ROAs in short, in the further slides. So we have many examples of that. Obviously, I have mentioned a few here. Superoxide anion, all of us are familiar. Hydrogen peroxide, lipid peroxide, peroxyl radicals, electron delocalized phenoxyl radical, nitric oxide. It's a free radical as well. And we have the hydroxyl radical, which is quite damaging to the tissues. So the hydroxyl radical represented as OH dot is one of the strongest oxidants in nature, and it may damage the tissues. There is no specific scavenger for this radical, and once released, it reacts with the lipoproteins, the cell membranes, the lipids, DNA, amino acids, causing structural and functional damage. So this is a reflection of how the free radical injury causes tissue damage. Almost all the reactive oxygen species cause damage by any of these mechanisms. The main source of the reactive oxygen species are as part of the NADPH oxidase reactions. In the first video on oxygen, we discussed the electron transport chain in the mitochondria, and the NADPH oxidase reactions happens in those regions. So it's also part of the reaction in the phagocytes after activation when they're exposed to microbes, microbial products or inflammatory mediators. So phagocytes are obviously brought into the tissues wherever there is inflammation, and so any inflammatory mediation can cause increased reactive oxygen species. So this point is very important to remember when we talk of maternal problems like chorioamnionitis and the effect of that on lung disease and so on in the baby. So the fetal outcome, both in terms of the brain outcome as well as the lung outcome, depends a lot on presence of inflammatory mediators at birth, and that is partly because of this increased reactive oxygen species. Then we have the reactive oxygen species as part of the mitochondrial metabolism. We have hypoxia and reoxygenation. This is typically seen in birth axial injury. So where we have secondary or reperfusion injury, the cooling is intended to reduce this type of injury. So here we have a hypoxanthine-xanthine oxidase reaction. Hyperoxia, of course, leads to reactive oxygen species. And paradoxically, hypoxia also leads to increased reactive oxygen species. So the nature of the products are different in each, but obviously the damage that happens, as we discussed earlier, at these cellular levels can happen both with hypoxia and hyperoxia. And the reoxygenation or reperfusion is important as well. So in terms of oxidative stress, we have an excess of reactive oxygen species in relation to the detoxification capacity, and that leads to oxidative stress. The detoxification capacity is nothing but the antioxidant system. So imbalance between oxidants and antioxidants leads to a potential damage of the tissues. Mild oxidative stress is seen quite commonly in our day-to-day life, and the cell and the antioxidant mechanisms we have in our body can protect us from such stress. However, severe oxidative stress is generally followed by cell injury, and any type of cell death like apoptosis, necrosis, autophagy, mitophagy, anything can be a relation to the severe oxidative stress. And remember that these can lead to hemolysis, it can increase the risk of NEC, it can increase the risk of brain damage. So any type of brain injury can happen from increased reactive oxygen species. And coming on to the defense mechanism itself in a little bit of detail, an antioxidant is a molecule capable of inhibiting the oxidation of other molecules. The antioxidant defense system can be primary or secondary. The antioxidants can neutralize the free radicals at three levels. We can call it prevention, interception, and repair. Prevention, an example is superoxide dismutase, which catalyzes the dismutation of superoxide to hydrogen peroxide. Catalase is an example as well, and this breaks down the hydrogen peroxide to water. In terms of interception, it's mainly the scavenging. So the scavenging of free radicals or peroxyl radicals in the tissue, and the molecules involved here include glutathione, the flavonoids, carotenoids, which is related to vitamin A, and vitamin C and E. Repair at the tissue repair level, like the ligase enzyme. We can also look at the primary, secondary, and tertiary antioxidant defense mechanisms. So the primary defense is mainly intended to look out for and protect the body from oxidant damage. So examples are the glutathione, uric acid, vitamin A, C, and E, and bilirubin in newborn babies. So we all know that vitamin A has been shown to have an impact in reducing BPD, and part of it is related to its role in maintaining the epithelial surface, but also it's due to its antioxidant effect. Vitamin C has been tried, and a high level of vitamin C can itself create oxidative stress, so we should be careful not to overdose it. Vitamin E has been tried to reduce problems related to retinopathy of prematurity with some success. However, there is an increased risk of sepsis in very small babies following such stress, and so we should be careful. Even though bilirubin is an antioxidant, very high levels of bilirubin obviously can cause brain injury, so it should not be advocated as a treatment. And in the extreme preterm babies, there has been increased mortality where you aggressively manage bilirubin, like prophylactic phototherapy. So we should exercise caution in management of bilirubin because of its role as an antioxidant. Remember that reactive oxygen species are part of the defense against infections as well through the phagocytes, and that's why too much of inhibition is also to be monitored carefully. So we also have the antioxidant scavenging systems like the peroxidases. In terms of secondary defense, these usually act after damage to the tissues, and these include the lipolytic enzymes, phospholipase, the proteolytic enzymes, and the DNA repair systems. So lastly, we will look at the impact of oxygen toxicity. So we have looked at the important role in tissue damage and how it can lead to different forms of cell death. So they also have an important role following on with this in the development of retinopathy of prematurity, chronic lung disease, necrotizing enterocolitis, renal failure, hemolytic anemia, septic shock, and brain damage, especially in the setting of pre-perfusion injury and perinatal asphyxia. The most important impact when we consider the reactive oxygen species injury is on chronic lung disease of prematurity and retinopathy of prematurity. So this is an illustration of a pathway where the chronic lung disease happens, and we have all the reactive oxygen species that we spoke of. Of course, it can affect the genetic level as well. DNA damage, altered gene expression may happen. So maternal exposure can lead to growth restriction, intrauterine stress, and even death. We have cytochrome C response in the mitochondria. Various enzymes are affected, and it has impact on the phagocyte. It has effect on apoptosis and cell death. The reactive oxygen species leads to inflammation in the lungs. There is disruption of the alveolar capillary membrane. There is microvascular endothelial injury, inflammation, edema, fibrosis happen. The alveolar flooding continues to occur. Relative surfactant inactivation is noted as well. And it has a secondary effect on the phosphodiesterase enzyme, role in the metabolism of cyclic GMP to GMP. There is pulmonary vasoconstriction, and this also contributes to pulmonary hypertension, which is a part of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So all these impacts are seen acutely, where you have greater difficulty ventilating such babies who have a significant inflammatory response. So the start of ventilation in the labor room is very important not to cause hyperoxia. Even the response of nitric oxide depends on the setting. So the enzymes are switched on or off in the presence of hyperoxia. So pulmonary vasoconstriction and a poorer response to nitric oxide may cause pulmonary hypertension as well. In terms of ROP and oxygen, so we have the role of vascular endothelial growth factor. And we have the normal retinal vascular development, which is stimulated by the VEGF, which is usually seen as to produce a new vessels as the vessels progress down the retina. And in the first phase of ROP, we have exposure to relative hyperoxia after birth, and this interrupts the gradient of physiologic hypoxia in the mature retina. This leads to downregulation of the VEGF, so the red marking the VEGF is absent here. This is associated with vaso-obliteration and cessation of vessel growth, which is seen as a ridge in the early stages of retinopathy of prematurity. As the metabolic demand of the developing retina increases, the non-perfuse portion of the retina becomes hypoxic. So the blood vessels are not available, so that area becomes hypoxic, and there is overproduction of VEGF as a result. So this is a cycle of hyperoxia and hypoxia. And the VEGF production results in neovascularization, and this produces the advanced stages of retinopathy of prematurity. When these vessels rupture is when we get retinal detachment. So neovascularization occurs in response to overproduction of VEGF, and if VEGF production persists, the ROP will progress. So you get plus disease, you get the dilated vessels which are seen. And if the VEGF levels decrease, then regression of ROP can happen. And this is the basis for the treatment with anti-VEGF factors that we use now, the Eylea or the bevacizumab and other products that are used injection into the vitreous to inhibit. So we have different factors. We have the free radicals, but however we have the fluctuation of hyperoxia, hypoxia, and in a premature baby, the switch from hemoglobin F to hemoglobin A that is initiated by the transfusions also plays a role. So to summarize and to end this video, we can say that reactive oxygen species plays a very important role in neonatal morbidity and mortality. The focus is on oxygen toxicity is important right from the labor room onwards, and we should advance measures to minimize the oxidative stress. We should support our antioxidant defense by maintaining adequate nutrition, including focus on adequate amounts of vitamin A, C and D. Caution should be exercised to avoid overdosing. Vitamin A, as we know, has a role in BPD, but it's involving 3 intramuscular injections weekly in the tiny babies, and so the uptake in the society, in the community, is not very high. We should minimize exposure to high levels of oxygen as well as significant fluctuations right from the labor room to the NICU stay. So as I discussed, we will be discussing oxygen in the delivery room in the next video. So I hope this is useful, and I request you to subscribe and share. Please turn on notifications as well so that you will be aware when the next video is coming up. Thank you.